In Troy, there lies the scene. From isles of Greece, the princes Orgulus, their high blood chafed, have to the port of Athens sent their ships, fraught with the ministers and instruments of cruel war. 69, that wore their crownets regal from the Athenian bay, put forth toward Phrygia, and their vow is made to ransack Troy, within whose strong emirs the ravished Helen, Menelaus' queen, with wanton Paris sleeps. And that's the quarrel. To Tenedos they come, and the deep-drawing barks do there disgorge their warlike fraughtage. Now, on Dardan plains, the fresh and yet unbruised Greeks do pitch their brave pavilions. Priam's six-gated city, Dardan and Timbria, Helias, Chites, Troian, and Antinorides, with massy staples and corresponsive and fulfilling bolts, spur up the sons of Troy. Now expectation, tickling skittish spirits, on one and other side, Trojan and Greek, sets all on hazard. And hither am I come, a prologue armed, but not in confidence of author's pen or actor's voice, but suited in like condition as our argument, to tell you, fair beholders, that our play leaps o'er the vaunt and firstlings of those broils, beginning in the middle, starting thence away to what may be digested in a play. Like or find fault, do as your pleasures are, now good or bad, 'tis but the chance of war.
Call here my varlet, I'll unarm again. Why should I war without the walls of Troy that find such cruel battle here within? Each Trojan that is master of his heart, let him to field. Troilus, alas, hath none.
Will this gear ne'er be mended?
The Greeks are strong and skillful to their strength, fierce to their skill and to their fierceness valiant. But I am weaker than a woman's tear, tamer than sleep, fonder than ignorance, less valiant than the virgin in the night, and skillless as unpracticed infancy.
Well, I have told you enough of this. For my part, I'll not meddle nor make no farther. He that will have a cake out of the wheat must tarry the grinding.
Have I not tarried?
Aye, the grinding. But you must tarry the bolting.
Have I not tarried?
Aye, the bolting. But you must tarry the leavening.
Still have I tarried.
Aye, to the leavening. But there's yet in the word hereafter the kneading, the making of the cake, the heating of the oven, and the baking. Nay, you must stay the cooling too, or you may chance to burn your lips.
Patience herself, what goddess e'er she be, doth lesser blench at sufferance than I do. At Priam's royal table do I sit, and when fair Cressid comes into my thoughts, so, traitor, when she comes, when is she thence?
Well, she looked yesternight fairer than ever I saw her look, or any woman else.
I was about to tell thee, when my heart, as wedged with a sigh, would rive in twain, lest Hector or my father should perceive me. I have, as when the sun doth light a storm, buried this sigh in wrinkle of a smile. But sorrow that is couched in seeming gladness is like that mirth fate turns to sudden sadness.
And her hair were not somewhat darker than Helen's. Well, go to. There were no more comparison between the women. But for my part, she is my kinswoman. I would not, as they term it, praise her, but I would somebody had heard her talk yesterday as I did. I will not dispraise your sister Cassandra's wit.
Oh, Pandarus, I tell thee, Pandarus, when I do tell thee there my hopes lie drowned, reply not in how many fathoms deep they lie entrenched. I tell thee I am mad in Cressid's love. Thou answerest she is fair. Forced in the open ulcer of my heart, her eyes, her hair, her cheek, her gait, her voice, handless in thy discourse. Oh, that her hand, in whose comparison all whites are ink, writing their own reproach, to whose soft seizure the signet's down is harsh, and spirit of sense hard as the palm of ploughman, This thou tell'st me, as true thou tell'st me when I say I love her, but saying thus, instead of oil and balm, thou layst in every gash that love hath given me the knife that made it.
I speak no more than truth.
Thou dost not speak so much.
Faith, I'll not meddle it. Let her be as she is. If she be fair, 'tis the better for her. And she be not, she has the men's in her own hands.
Good Pandarus! How now, Pandarus?
I have had my labor for my travel. Ill thought on of her, and ill thought on of you. Gone between and between, but small thanks for my labor.
What, art thou angry, Pandarus? What, with me?
Because she's kin to me. Therefore she's not so fair as Helen. And she were not kin to me, she would be as fair a Friday as Helen is a Sunday. But what care I? I care not, and she were a blackamoor. It is all one to me.
Say I she is not fair.
I do not care whether you do or no. She's a fool to stay behind her father. Let her to the Greeks. And so I'll tell her the next time I see her. For my part, I'll meddle nor make no more of the matter.
Pandarus.
Not I.
Sweet Pandarus.
Can you speak no more to me? I will leave all as I found it, and there an end.
Peace, you ungracious clamors. Peace, rude sounds, fools on both sides. Helen must needs be fair when with your blood you daily paint her thus. I cannot fight upon this argument. It is too starved a subject for my sword. But Pandarus, oh gods, how do you plague me? I cannot come to Cressid but by Pandar. And he's as tetchy to be wooed to woo as she is stubborn traced against all suit. Tell me, Apollo, for thy Daphne's love, what Cressid is, what Pandar, and what we. Her bed is India. There she lies, a pearl. Between our Ilium and where she resides, let it be called the wild and wandering flood. Ourself the merchant, and this sailing Pandar, our doubtful hope, our convoy, and our bark.
How now, Prince Troilus? Wherefore not afield?
Because not there. This woman's answer sorts for womanish it is to be from thence. What news, Aeneas, from the field today?
That Paris is returned home and hurt.
By whom, Aeneas?
Troilus, by Menelaus.
Let Paris bleed. 'Tis but a scar to scorn. Paris is gored by Menelaus' horn.
Hark, what good sport is out of town today.
Better at home, if would I might were may. But to the sport abroad, are you bound thither?
In all swift haste.
Come, go we then together.
Who were those went by?
Queen Hecuba and Helen.
And whither go they?
Up to the eastern tower, whose height commands a subject to all the vale to see the battle. Hector, whose patience is as a virtue fixed, today was moved. He chid Andromache and struck his armorer. And like as there were husbandry in war, before the sun rose he was harnessed light, and to the field goes he, where every flower did as a prophet weep what it foresaw in Hector's wrath.
What was his cause of anger?
The noise goes this. There is among the Greeks a lord of Trojan blood, nephew to Hector. They call him Ajax.
Good, and what of him?
They say he is a very man per se and stands alone.
So do all men, unless they are drunk, sick, or have no legs.
This man, lady, hath robbed many beasts of their particular additions. He's as valiant as the lion, churlish as the bear, slow as the elephant. A man into whom nature hath so crowded humors that his valor is crushed into folly, his folly forced with discretion. There is no man hath a virtue that he hath not a glimpse of, nor any man an attaint but he carries some stain of it. He's melancholy without cause, and merry against the hair. He hath the joints of everything, but everything so out of joint that he is a gouty Briareus, many hands and no use, or purblind Argus, all eyes and no sight.
But how should this man that makes me smile make Hector angry?
They say he yesterday coped Hector in the battle, and struck him down. The disdain and shame whereof hath ever since kept Hector fasting and waking.
Who comes here?
Oh, madam, your uncle Pandarus.
Hector! Hector's a gallant man.
As may be in the world, lady.
What's that? What's that?
Good morrow, Uncle the Pandarus.
Good morrow, Cousin Cressid. What do you talk of? Good morrow, Alexander. How do you, cousin? When were you at Ilium?
This morning, Uncle.
What were you talking of when I came? Was Hector armed and gone ere you came to Ilium? Helen was not up, was she?
Hector was gone, but Helen was not up.
E'en so. Hector was stirring early.
That were we talking of, and his anger.
Was he angry?
So he says here.
True. He was so. I know the cause, too. He'll lay about him today, I can tell them that. And there's Troilus will not come far behind him. Let them take heed of Troilus, I can tell them that, too.
What, is he angry, too?
Ooh, Troilus? Troilus is the better man of the two.
Oh, Jupiter, there's no comparison.
Not between Troilus and Hector? Do you know a man if you see him?
Aye, if I ever saw him before and knew him.
Well, I say Troilus is Troilus.
Well, then you say as I say, for I'm sure he's not Hector.
No, nor Hector is not Troilus in some degrees.
Tis just to each of them he is himself.
Himself. Alas, poor Troilus, I would he were.
So he is.
Condition I had gone barefoot to India.
He is not Hector.
Himself. No, he's not himself. Would aware himself. Well, the gods are above. Time must friend or end. Well, Troilus, well, I would my heart were in her body. No, Hector is not a better man than Troilus.
Excuse me.
He is elder.
Pardon me, pardon me.
T'other's not come to it. You shall tell me another tale when t'other's come to it. Hector shall not have his wit this year.
He shall not need it if he have his own.
Nor his qualities.
No matter.
Nor his beauty.
'Twould not become him. His own's better.
You have no judgment, niece. Helen herself swore t'other day that Troilus, for a brown favour, for so 'tis, I must confess, not brown, neither.
No, but brown.
Faith, to say the truth, brown and not brown.
To say the truth, the true and not true.
She praised his complexion above Paris.
Why, Paris hath colour enough.
So he has.
Then Troilus should have too much. If she praised him above, his complexion is higher than his. He having colour enough and the other higher is too flaming a praise for a good complexion. I had as lief Helen's golden tongue had commended Troilus for a copper nose.
I swear to you, I think Helen loves him better than Paris.
Then she's a merry Greek indeed.
Nay, I am sure she does. She came to him t'other day into the compassed window, and you know he has not passed 3 or 4 hairs on his chin.
Indeed, a tapster's arithmetic may soon bring his particulars therein to a total.
Why, he is very young, and yet will he within 3 pound lift as much as his brother Hector?
Is he so young a man and so old a lifter?
But to prove to you that Helen loves him, she came and puts me her white hand to his cloven chin.
Juno, have mercy. How came it cloven?
Why, you know, 'tis dimpled. Oh. I think his smiling becomes him better than any man in all Phrygia.
Oh, he smiles valiantly.
Does he not?
Oh, yes, and 'twere a cloud in autumn.
Why, go to then. But to prove to you that Helen loves Troilus.
Troilus will stand to the proof, if you'll prove it, sir.
Troilus? Why, he esteems her no more than I esteem an addle egg.
If you love an addle egg as well as you love an idle head, you would eat chickens of the shell.
I cannot choose but laugh to think how she tickled his chin. Indeed, she has a marvellous white hand, I must needs confess.
Without the rack.
And she takes upon her to spy a white hair on his chin.
Alas, poor chin, many a wart is richer.
But there was such laughing. Queen Hecuba laughed that her eyes ran o'er.
With millstones.
And Cassandra laughed.
But there was a more temperate fire under the pot of her eyes. Did her eyes run o'er too?
And Hector laughed.
At what was all this laughing?
Very. At the white hair that Helen spied on Troilus' chin.
And been a green hair, I should have laughed too.
They laughed not so much at the hair as at his pretty answer.
What was his answer?
Quoth she, "Here's but 52 hairs on your chin, and one of them is white."
This is her question.
That's true. Make no question of that. 52 hairs, quoth he, and one white. That white hair is my father, and all the rest are his sons. Jupiter, quoth she, which of these hairs is Paris, my husband? The forked one, quoth he, pluck it out and give it him. But there was such laughing, and Helen so blushed, and Paris so chafed, and all the rest so laughed, that it passed.
Well, so let it now, for it has been a great while going by.
Well, cousin, I told you a thing yesterday. Think on't.
So I do.
I'll be sworn 'tis true. He will weep you and 'twere a man born in April.
And I'll spring up in his tears and 'twere a nettle against May.
Hark! They're coming from the field. Shall we stand up here and see them as they pass toward Ireland? Good niece, do. Sweet niece, Cressida.
At your pleasure.
Here, here. Here's an excellent place. Here we may see most bravely. I'll tell you them all by their names as they pass by. But mark Troilus above the rest.
Speak not so loud.
That's Aeneas. Is not that a brave man? He's one of the flowers of Troy, I can tell you. But mark Troilus. You shall see Troilus anon.
Who's that?
That's Antenor. He has a shrewd wit, I can tell you. And he's a man good enough. He's one of the soundest judgments in Troy, whosoever. And a proper man of person. Then comes Troilus. I'll show you Troilus anon. If he see me, you shall see him nod at me.
Will he give you the nod?
You shall see.
If he do, the rich shall have more.
That's Hector. That. Look you, that. There's a fellow. Go thy way, Hector. There's a brave man, niece. Oh, brave Hector. Look how he looks. There's a countenance. Is not a brave man?
Oh, a brave man.
Is a knot. It does a man's heart good. Look you what hacks are on his helmet. Look you yonder, do you see? Look you there. There's no jesting. There's laying on. Take the fool will, as they say. There be hacks.
Be those with swords?
Swords, anything. He cares not. And the devil come to him, it's all one. By God's lid, it does one's heart good. Yonder comes Paris. Look ye yonder, niece. Is not a gallant man, too, is not? Why, this is brave now. Who said he came home hurt today? He's not hurt. Why, this will do Helen's heart good now. Would I could see Troilus now. You shall see Troilus anon.
Who's that?
That's Helenus. I marvel where Troilus is. That's Helenus. I think he went not forth today. That's Helenus.
Can Helenus fight, Uncle?
Helenus? No. Yes, she'll fight indifferent well. I marvel where Troilus is. Hark, do you not hear the people cry, Troilus? Helenus is a priest.
What sneaking fellow comes yonder?
Where? Yonder? That's Deiphobus. Tis Troilus. There's a man, niece. Brave Troilus, the prince of chivalry.
Peace, for shame, peace.
Mark him, note him. Oh, brave Troilus, look well upon him, niece. Look you, how his sword is bloodied and his helm more hacked than Hector's, and how he looks and how he goes. Oh, admirable youth. He now saw 23. Go thy way, Troilus, go thy way. Had I a sister were a grace or a daughter a goddess, he should take his choice. Oh, admirable man. Paris is dirt to him, and I warrant Helen to change would give an eye to boot.
Here come more.
Asses, fools, dolts. Chaff and bran, porridge after meat. I could live and die in the eyes of Troilus. There, look. The eagles are gone. Crows and daws. I'd rather be such a man as Troilus than Agamemnon and all Greece.
There is among the Greeks Achilles, a better man than Troilus.
Achilles, a drayman, a porter, a very camel.
Well.
Why, have you any discretion? Have you any eyes? Do you know what a man is? Is not birth, beauty, good shape, discourse, manhood, learning, gentleness, virtue, youth, liberality, and such like. The spice and salt that season a man.
I a minced man, and then to be baked with no date in the pie, for then the man's date is out.
You are such another woman. A man knows not at what ward you lie.
upon my back to defend my belly, upon my wit to defend my wiles, upon my secrecy to defend mine honesty, my mask to defend my beauty, and you to defend all these, and at all these wards I lie at 1,000 watches.
Say one of your watches.
Nay, I'll watch you for that, and that's one of the chiefest of them, too. If I cannot ward what I would not have hit, I can watch you for telling how I took the blow, unless it's well past hiding, and then it's past watching.
You are such another.
Sir, my lord would instantly speak with you.
Where?
At your own house. There he unarms him.
Good boy. Tell him I come. I doubt he'll be hurt. Fare ye well, good niece.
Adieu, uncle.
I'll be with you, niece, by and by.
To bring, uncle.
By a token from Troilus.
By the same token, you are aboard. Words, vows, gifts, tears, and love's full sacrifice he offers in another's enterprise. But more in Troilus thousandfold I see than in the glass of Pandarus' praise may be. Yet hold I off. Women are angels wooing. Things won are done. Joy's soul lies in the doing. That she beloved knows not that knows not this. Men prize the thing ungained more than it is. That she was never yet that ever knew love got so sweet as when desire did sue. Therefore this maxim out of love I teach. Achievement is command, ungained beseech. Then though my heart's content firm love doth bear, nothing of that shall from mine eyes appear.
Princes, what grief hath set this jaundice on your cheeks? The ample proposition that hope makes in all designs begun on earth below fails in the promised largeness. Checks and disasters grow in the veins of action's highest reared, as knots by the conflux of meeting sap infect the sound pine and divert his grain tortive and errant from his course of growth. Nor, princes, is it matter new to us that we come short of our suppose so far that after 7 years' siege yet Troy walls stand. Sith every action that hath gone before, whereof we have record, trial did draw bias and thwart, not answering the aim, and that unbodied figure of the thought that gave surmise its shape. Why then, you princes, do you with cheeks abashed behold our works and call them shame? Which are indeed naught else but the protractive trials of great Jove, to pind persistive constancy in men. The fineness of which metal is not found in fortune's love. For then the bold and coward, the wise and fool, the artist and unread, the hard and soft, seem all affined and kin. But in the wind and tempest of her frown, distinction, with a broad and powerful fan, puffing at all, winnows the light away. And what hath mass or matter by itself lies rich in virtue and unmingled.
With due observance of thy godlike seat, great Agamemnon, Nestor shall apply thy latest words. In the reproof of chance lies the true proof of men. The sea being smooth, how many shallow bauble boats dare sail upon her patient breast, making their way with those of nobler bulk? But let the ruffian Boreas once enrage the gentle Thetis, and anon behold the strong-ribbed bark through liquid mountains cut, bounding between the two moist elements like Perseus' horse. Where's then the saucy boat, whose weak untimbered sides but even now co-rivaled greatness, either to harbor fled, or made a toast for Neptune? Even so doth valor's show and valor's worth divide in storms of fortune. For in her ray and brightness, the herd hath more annoyance by the breeze than by the tiger. But when the splitting wind makes flexible the knees of knotted oaks, and flies flee under shade, why, then the thing of courage, as roused with rage doth sympathize, and with an accent tuned in self-same key, retorts to chiding fortune.
Agamemnon, thou great commander, nerve and bone of Greece, heart of our numbers, soul and only spirit, in whom the tempers and the minds of all should be shut up, hear what Ulysses speaks. Besides the applause and approbation, the which, most mighty for thy place and sway, and thou most reverend for thy stretched out life, I give to both your speeches, which were such as, Agamemnon, all the hands of Greece should hold up high in brass, and such again as, venerable Nestor, hatched in silver, should with a bond of air, strong as the axle tree on which heaven rides, knit all the Greekish ears to his experienced tongue. Yet let it please both, thou great and wise, to hear Ulysses speak.
Speak, Prince of Ithaca, and be it of less expect that matter needless, of importless burden, divide thy lips, then we are confident when rank Thersites opes his mastic jaws, we shall hear music, wit, and oracle.
Troy, yet upon his basis had been dark, and the great Hector's sword had lacked a master, but for these instances, the specialty of rule hath been neglected. And look how many Grecian tents do stand hollow upon this plain, so many hollow factions. When that the general is not like the hive, to whom the foragers shall all repair, what honey is expected? Degree being visited, the unworthiest shows as fairly in the mask. The heavens themselves, the planets, and this center, observe degree, priority, and place, insisture, course, proportion, season, form, office, and custom, in all line of order. And therefore is the glorious planet Sol, in noble eminence, enthroned and sphered amidst the other, whose medicinable eye corrects the influence of evil planets and posts, like the commandment of a king, stands checked of good and bad. But when the planets in evil mixture to disorder wander, what plagues and what portents, what mutiny, what raging of the sea, shaking of earth, commotion in the winds, frights, changes, horrors, divert and crack, rend and deracinate the unity and married calm of states quite from their fixture. Oh, when degree is shaked, which is the ladder of all high designs, the enterprise is sick. How could communities, degrees in schools and brotherhoods in cities, peaceful commerce from divitable shores, the primogenitive and due of birth, prerogative of age, crowns, scepters, laurels, but by degree stand in authentic place? Take but degree away, untune that string, and hark what discord follows. Each thing meets in mere oppugnancy. The bounded waters should lift their bosoms higher than the shores and make a sop of all this solid globe. Strength should be lord of imbecility, and the rude son should strike his father dead. Force should be right, or rather right and wrong, between whose endless jar justice resides, should lose their names, and so should justice too. Then everything includes itself in power. Power into will, will into appetite, and appetite, an universal wolf, so doubly seconded with will and power, must make perforce an universal prey, and last eat up himself. Great Agamemnon, this chaos, when degree is suffocate, follows the choking, and this neglection of degree it is, that by a pace goes backward with a purpose it hath to climb. The general's disdained by him one step below, he by the next by him beneath. So every step, exampled by the first pace that is sick of his superior, grows to an envious fever of pale and bloodless emulation. A 'Tis this fever that keeps Troy on foot, not her own sinews. To end the tale of length, Troy in our weakness stands, not in her strength.
Most wisely hath Ulysses here discovered the fever whereof all our power is sick.
The nature of the sickness found, Ulysses. What is the remedy?
The great Achilles, whom opinion crowns the sinew and the forehand of our host, having his ear full of his airy fame, grows dainty of his worth, and in his tent lies mocking our desires. With him, Patroclus, upon a lazy bed, the livelong day breaks scurril jests, and with ridiculous and awkward action, which slanderer he imitation calls, he pageants us. Sometime, great Agamemnon, thy topless deputation he puts on, and like a strutting player, whose conceit lies in his hamstring, had to think it rich to hear the wooden dialogue and sound twixt his stretched footing and the scaffoldage, such to be pitied and o'er-rested seeming, he acts thy greatness in. And when he speaks, as like a chime amending, with terms unsquared, which from the tongue of roaring Typhon dropped, would seem hyperboles. At this fusty stuff, the large Achilles on his pressed bed lolling, from his deep chest laughs out a loud applause, cries, "Excellent! 'Tis Agamemnon right! Now pay me Nestor! Hem, and stroke thy beard, as he being dressed to the summeration." That's done, as near as the extremest end of parallels, as like as Vulcan and his wife. Yet god Achilles still cries, "Excellent! 'Tis Nestor right! Now pay him me, Patroclus, arming to answer in a night alarm." And then, forsooth, the faint defects of age must be the scene of mirth, to cough and spit, and with a palsy fumbling on his gorget, shake in and out the rivet. And at this sport, Sir Valor dies, cries, "Oh, enough, Patroclus, or give me ribs of steel, I shall split all in pleasure of my spleen." And in this all our abilities, gifts, natures, shapes, severals and generals of grace exact, achievements, plots, orders, preventions, excitements to the field or speech for truce, success or loss, what is or is not, serves as stuff for these two to make paradoxes.
And in the imitation of these twain, who, as Ulysses says, opinion crowns with an imperial voice, many are infected. Ajax is grown self-willed, and bears his head in such a rein, in full as proud a place as broad Achilles, keeps his tent like him, makes factious feasts, rails on our state of war, bold as an oracle, and sets Thersites, a slave whose gall coin slanders like a mint, to match us in comparisons with dirt, to weaken and discredit our exposure, our rank soever rounded in with danger.
They tax our policy and call it cowardice, count wisdom as no member of the war, forestall prescience and esteem no act but that of hand. For still and mental parts that do contrive how many hands shall strike when fitness calls them on, and know by measure of their observant toil the enemy's weight, why, this has not a finger's dignity. They call this bedwork, mappery, closet war. So that the ram that batters down the wall for the great swing and rudeness of his poise, they place before his hand that made the engine, or those that with the fineness of their souls by reason guide his execution.
Let this be granted, and Achilles' horse makes many Thetis' sons.
What trumpet? Look, Menelaus,
from Troy.
What would you for our tent?
Is this great Agamemnon's tent, I pray you?
Even this?
May one that is a herald and a prince do a fair message to his kingly eyes?
With surety stronger than Achilles' arms for all the Greekish heads, which with one voice call Agamemnon head and general.
Fair leave and large security. How may a stranger to those most imperial looks know them from eyes of other mortals?
How?
Aye. I ask that I might waken reverence and bid the cheek be ready with a blush modest as morning when she coldly eyes the youthful Phoebus. Which is that god in office guiding men? Which is the high and mighty Agamemnon?
This Trojan scorns us, or the men of Troy are ceremonious courtiers.
Courtiers as free, as debonair, unarmed, as bending angels. That's their fame in peace. But when they would seem soldiers, they have galls, good arms, strong joints, true swords, and Jove's accord, nothing so full of heart. But peace, Aeneas. Peace, Trojan. Lay thy finger on thy lips. The worthiness of praise disdains his worth if that the praised himself bring the praise forth. But what the repining enemy commends, that breath fame blows. That praise, soul pure, transcends.
Sir, you of Troy, call you yourself Aeneas?
I, Greek, that is my name.
What's your affair, I pray you?
Sir, pardon, 'tis for Agamemnon's ears.
He hears not privately that comes from Troy.
Nor I from Troy, come not to whisper him. I bring a trumpet to awake his ear, to set his sense on the attentive bent, and then to speak.
Speak, frankly, as the wind. It is not Agamemnon's sleeping hour. That thou shalt know, Trojan, he is awake. He tells thee so himself.
Trumpet, blow loud. Send thy brass voice through all these lazy tents. And every Greek of metal, let him know. What Troy means fairly shall be spoke aloud. We have great Agamemnon here in Troy, a prince called Hector. Priam is his father, who in this dull and long-continued truce is resty grown. He bade me take a trumpet, and to this purpose speak. Kings, princes, lords, if there be one amongst the fairest of Greece that holds his honor higher than his ease, that seeks his praise more than he fears his peril, that knows his valor and knows not his fear, that loves his mistress more than in confession with truant vows to her own lips he loves, and dare avow her beauty and her worth in other arms than hers, to him this challenge. Hector, in view of Trojans and of Greeks, shall make it good, or do his best to do it. He hath a lady, wiser, fairer, truer, than ever Greek did couple in his arms, and will tomorrow, with his trumpet call, midway between your tents and walls of Troy, to rouse a Grecian that is true in love. If any come, Hector shall honor him. If none, he'll say in Troy when he returns, the Grecian dames are sunburnt, and not worth the splinter of a lance. Even so much.
This shall be told our lovers, Lord Aeneas. If none of them have soul in such a kind, we left them all at home. But we are soldiers, and may that soldier a mere recreant prove that means not, hath not, or is not in love. If then one is, or hath, or means to be, that one meets Hector. If none else, I am he.
Tell him of Nestor, one that was a man when Hector's grandsire sucked. He is old now, but if there be not in our Grecian host one noble man that hath one spark of fire to answer for his love, tell him from me. I'll hide my silver beard in a gold beaver, and in my vaunt's brace put this withered brawn, and meeting him, will tell him that my lady was fairer than his grandam, and as chaste as may be in the world. His youth in flood, I'll prove this troth with my 3 drops of blood.
Now, heavens, forfend such scarcity of youth.
Amen.
Fair Lord Aeneas, let me touch your hand. To our pavilion shall I lead you first. Achilles shall have word of this intent. So shall each lord of Greece from tent to tent. Yourself shall feast with us before you go, and find the welcome of a noble foe.
Nestor.
What says Ulysses?
I have a young conception in my brain. Be you my time to bring it to some shape.
What is't?
This 'tis. Blunt wedges rive hard knots. The seeded pride that hath to this maturity blown up in rank Achilles must or now be cropped, or shedding breed a nursery of like evil to overbulk us all.
Well, and how?
This challenge that the gallant Hector sends, however it is spread in general name, relates in purpose only to Achilles.
True. The purpose is perspicuous as substance, whose grossness little characters sum up, and in the publication make no strain but that Achilles, were his brain as barren as banks of Libya, though Apollo knows 'tis dry enough, will, with great speed of judgment, aye, with celerity, find Hector's purpose pointing on him.
And wake him to the answer, think you?
Why, 'tis most meet. Who may well suppose that can from Hector bring his honor off, if not Achilles? Though 't be a sportful combat, yet in this trial much opinion dwells. For here the Trojans taste our dearest repute with their finest palate. And trust to me, Ulysses, our imputation shall be oddly poised in this wild action. For the success, although particular, shall give a scantling of good or bad unto the general. And in such indexes, although small pricks to their subsequent volumes, there is seen the baby figure of the giant mass of things to come at large. It is supposed he that meets Hector issues from our choice, and choice, being mutual act of all our souls, makes merit her election, and doth boil, as 'twere from forth us all, a man distilled out of our virtues, who, miscarrying what heart receives from hence a conquering part, to steal a strong opinion to themselves, which, entertained, limbs are his instruments, e'en no less working than our swords and bows, directive by the limbs.
Give pardon to my speech. Therefore 'tis meet Achilles, meet not Hector. Let us, like merchants, first show foul wares, and think perchance they'll sell. If not, the luster of the better shall exceed by showing the worse first. Do not consent that ever Hector and Achilles meet, for both our honor and our shame in this are dogged with two strange followers.
I see them not with my old eyes. What are they?
What glory our Achilles shares from Hector? Were he not proud, we all should share with him. But he already is too insolent, and we were better parch in Afric's sun than in the pride and salt scorn of his eyes, should he scape Hector fair. If he were foiled, why, then we did our main opinion crush in taint of our best man. No, make a lottery. And by device, let blockish Ajax draw the sort to fight with Hector. Among ourselves, give him allowance as the better man, for that will physic the great myrmidon, who broils in loud applause, and make him fall his crest that prouder than blue Aris bends. If the dull, brainless Ajax come safe off, we'll dress him up in voices. If he fail, yet go we under our opinion still that we have better men. But hit or miss, our project's life this shape of sense assumes. Ajax employed plucks down Achilles' plumes.
Ulysses, now I begin to relish thy advice, and I will give a taste thereof forthwith to Agamemnon. Go we to him straight. Two curs shall tame each other. Pride alone must tar the mastiffs on, as 'twere their bone. Agamemnon, how if he had boys, full, all over, generally?
Thersites!
And those boils did run, say so. Did not the general run then? Were not that a botchy car?
Dog!
Then there would come some matter from him. I see none.
Thou bitch wolf's son, canst thou not hear? Freeland!
No! A plague of grease upon thee, thou mongrel, beef-witted lord!
Speak, then, thou vinuidst leaven, speak. I will beat thee into handsomeness.
I shall sooner rail thee into wit and holiness. But I think thy horse will sooner con an oration than thou learn a prayer without a book. Oh! Thou canst strike, canst thou? A red murrain of thy jade's tricks.
Toadstool, learn me the proclamation.
Dost thou think I have no sense thou strikest me thus?
The proclamation?
Thou art proclaimed a fool, I think.
Do not, Porpentine, do not, my fingers itch.
Why wouldst thou didst itch from head to foot, and I had the scratching of thee? I would make thee the loathsomest scab in Greece. When thou art forth in the incursions, thou strikest as slow as another.
I say the proclamation!
Thou grumblest and railest every hour on Achilles, and thou art as full of envy at his greatness as Cerberus is at Proserpina's beauty. Ay, that thou barkst at him!
Mistress Thersites.
Ah! Thou shouldst strike him!
Carblow!
He would pun thee into shivers with his fist as a sailor breaks a biscuit.
You, horse and cur!
Do, thou stool for a witch. Aye, do, thou sodden-witted lord. Thou hast no more brain in thy head than I have in mine elbows. An asinigo may tutor thee, thou scurvy, valiant ass. Thou art here but to thrash Trojans, and thou art bought and sold among those of any wit like a barbarian slave. If thou use to beat me, I will begin at thy heels and tell thee what thou art by inches, thou thing of no bowels, thou.
You dog!
You scurvy lord!
You cur!
Mars, he's idiot! Do, Rubens! Do, camel! Do! Do!
Why, how now, Ajax? Wherefore do you thus? Had out, Thersites? What's the matter, man?
You see him there, do you?
Why? What's the matter?
Nay, look upon him.
So I do. What's the matter?
Nay, but regard him well.
Well, why, so I do.
But yet you look not well upon him. For whomsoever you take him to be, he is Ajax.
I know that, fool.
Aye, but the fool knows not himself.
Therefore I beat thee.
No. What modicums of wit he utters. His evasions have ears thus long. I have bobbed his brain more than he has beat my bones. I will buy 9 sparrows for a penny, and his peer mater is not worth the 9th part of a sparrow. This Lord Achilles, Ajax, who wears his wit in his belly and his guts in his head, I'll tell you what I say of him.
What?
I say this Ajax,
nay, good Ajax,
has not so much wit,
nay, I must
as will
you
stop the eye of Helen's needle for whom he comes to fight.
Cease, fool.
I would have peace and quietness, but the fool will not. That he there, look you there.
Oh, thou damn cur, I shall...
Will you set your wit to a fool?
No, I warrant you, for the fools will shame it.
Good words, Thersites. What's the quarrel?
I bade the vile owl go learn me the tenor of the proclamation, and he rails upon me.
I serve thee not.
Well, go to.
I serve here voluntary.
Your last service was sufferance. 'Twas not voluntary. No man is beaten voluntarily,
Ajax was here, the voluntary, and you as under an impress.
In so a great deal of your wit too lies in your sinews, or else they be liars. Hector shall have a great catch and a knock out either of your brains. I would as good crack a fusty nut with no kernel.
What with me too, Thersites?
There's Ulysses and old Nestor, whose wit was mouldier your grandsires had nails on their toes. Yoke you like draft oxen and make you plough up the war.
What?
Yes, good sooth. Two Achilles, two Ajax, two...
I shall cut out your tongue.
It is no matter. I shall speak as much wit as thou afterwards.
No more words, Thersites. Peace.
I will hold my peace when Achilles brach bids me, shall I?
There's for you, Patroclus.
I will see you hanged like clotholes ere I come any more to your tent. I will keep where there is wit stirring and leave the faction of fools.
Good riddance.
Mary, this, sir, is proclaimed through all our host, that Hector, by the fifth hour of the sun, will with a trumpet twixt our tents and Troy, tomorrow morning call some knight to arms that hath a stomach and such a one that dare maintain, I know not what. 'Tis trash. Farewell.
Farewell. Who shall answer him?
I know not. 'Tis put to lottery. Otherwise, he knew his man.
Oh. Meaning you. I'll go learn more of it.
After so many hours, lives, speeches spent, thus once again, says Nestor from the Greek, deliver Helen, and all damage else, as honor, loss of time, travail, expense, wounds, friends, and what else, dear, that is consumed in hot digestion of this cormorant war, shall be struck off. Hector, what say you to it?
Though no man lesser fears the Greeks than I, as far as toucheth my particular, yet, dread Priam, there is no lady of more softer bowels, more spongy to suck in the sense of fear, more ready to cry out, who knows what follows, than Hector is. The wound of peace is surety, surety secure. But modest doubt is called the beacon of the wise, the tent that searches to the bottom of the worst. Let Helen go. Since the first sword was drawn about this question, every tithe soul amongst many thousand dimes hath been as dear as Helen, I mean of ours. If we have lost so many tenths of ours to guard a thing not ours, nor worth to us had it our name the value of 1/10, what merits in that reason which denies the yielding of her up?
Fie, my brother. Were you the worth and honor of a king, so great as our dread father, in a scale of common ounces? Will you with counters sum the past proportion of his infinite, and buckle in a waist most fathomless, with spans and inches so diminutive as fears and reasons? Fie for godly shame.
No marvel, though you bite so sharp at reasons, you are so empty of them. Should not our father bear the great sway of his affairs with reasons, because your speech hath none that tells him so?
You have for dreams and slumbers, brother priest. You fur your gloves with reasons. Here are your reasons. You know an enemy intends you harm. You know a sword employed is perilous, and reason flies the object of all harm. Who marvels, then, when Helenus beholds a Grecian and his sword, if he do set the very wings of reason to his heels and fly like chidden Mercury from Jove, or like a star disorbed? Nay, if we talk of reason, let's shut our gates and sleep. Manhood and honor should have hare hearts, would they but fat their thoughts with this crammed reason. Reason and respect make livers pale and lustihood deject.
Brother, she is not worth what she doth cost the keep.
What's aught but is this value?
But value dwells not in particular will. It holds his estimate and dignity as well wherein 'tis precious of itself as in the prizer. 'Tis mad idolatry to make the service greater than the god, and the will dotes that is attributive to what infectiously itself affects without some image of the affected merit.
I take today a wife,
and my election is led on in the conduct of my will. My will, enkindled by mine eyes and ears, two traded pilots twixt the dangerous shores of will and judgment. How may I avoid, although my will distaste what it elected, the wife I chose? There can be no evasion to blench from this and to stand firm by honor. We turn not back the silks upon the merchant when we have soiled them, nor the remainder viands we do not throw in unrespective sieve, because we are now a full. It was thought meet Paris should do some vengeance on the Greeks. Your breath of full consent bellied his sails. The seas and winds, old wranglers, took a truce and did him service. He touched the ports desired. And for an old aunt, whom the Greeks held captive, he brought a Grecian queen, whose youth and freshness wrinkles Apollo's and makes pale the morning. Why keep we her? The Grecians keep our aunt. Is she worth keeping? Why, she is a pearl whose price hath launched above 1,000 ships and turned crowned kings to merchants. If you'll avouch 'twas wisdom Paris went, as you must needs, for you all cried, go, go. If you'll confess he brought home worthy prize, as you must needs, for you all clapped your hands and cried, inestimable. Why do you now, the issue of your proper wisdom's rate, and do a deed that fortune never did, beggar the estimation which you prized richer than sea and land? Oh, theft most base, that we have stolen what we do fear to keep. But thieves, unworthy of a thing so stolen, that in their country did them that disgrace, we fear to warrant in our native place.
Cry, Trojans, cry!
What noise, what shriek is this?
'Tis our mad sister. I do know her voice.
Cry, Trojans!
It is Cassandra.
Cry, Trojans, cry! Lend me 10,000 eyes, and I will fill them with prophetic tears.
Peace, sister, peace.
Virgins and boys, mid-age and wrinkled eld, soft infancy that nothing can but cry, add to my clamors. Let us pay betimes a moiety of that mass of moan to come. Cry, Trojans, cry. Practice your eyes with tears. Troy must not be, nor goodly Ilion stand. Our firebrand brother, Paris, burns us all. Cry, Trojans, cry. A Helen and a woe. Cry, cry. Troy burns. Or else, let Helen go.
Now, youthful Troilus, do not these high strains of divination in our sister work some touches of remorse? Or is your blood so madly hot that no discourse of reason nor fear of bad success in a bad cause can qualify the same?
Why, brother Hector, we may not think the justness of each act such no other than event doth form it, nor once deject the courage of our minds because Cassandra's mad. Her brain-sick raptures cannot distaste the goodness of a quarrel which hath our several honors all engaged to make it gracious. For my private part, I am no more touched than all Priam's sons, and Jove forbid there should be done amongst us such things as might offend the weakest spleen to fight for and maintain.
Else might the world convince of levity, as well my undertakings as your counsels. But I attest the gods, your full consent gave wings to my propension and cut off all fears attending on so dire a project. For what, alas, can these my single arms? What propugnation is in one man's valor to stand the push and enmity of those this quarrel would excite? Yet I protest, were I alone to pass the difficulties and had as ample power as I have will, Paris should ne'er retract what he hath done nor faint in the pursuit.
Paris, you speak like one besotted on your sweet delights. You have the honey still, but these, the gall, so to be valiant is no praise at all.
Sir, I propose not merely to myself the pleasures such a beauty brings with it, but I would have the soil of her fair rape wiped off in honorable keeping her. What treason were it to the ransack queen, disgrace to your great worth, and shame to me now to deliver her possession up on terms of base compulsion. Can it be that so degenerate a strain as this should once set footing in your generous bosoms? There's not the meanest spirit in our party without a heart to dare or sword to draw when Helen is defended, nor none so noble whose life were ill bestowed or death unfeigned, where Helen is the subject. Then I say, well may we fight for her whom we know well, the world's large spaces cannot parallel.
Paris and Troilus, you have both said well, and on the cause and question now in hand have glosed, but superficially. Not much unlike young men whom Aristotle thought unfit to hear moral philosophy. The reasons you allege do more conduce to the hot passion of distempered blood than to make up a free determination twixt right and wrong. For pleasure and revenge have ears more deaf than adders to the voice of any true decision. Nature craves all dues be rendered to their owners. Now, what nearer debt in all humanity than wife is to the husband? If this law of nature be corrupted through affection, and that great minds of partial indulgence to their benumbed wills resist the same, there is a law in each well-ordered nation to curb those raging appetites that are most disobedient and refractory. If Helen then be wife to Sparta's king, as it is known she is, these moral laws of nature and of nations speak aloud to have her back returned. Thus to persist in doing wrong extenuates not wrong, but makes it much more heavy. Hector's opinion is this, in way of truth. Yet nevertheless, my sprightly brethren, I prepend to you in resolution to keep Helen still, for 'tis a cause that hath no mean dependence upon our joint and several dignities.
Why, there you touch the life of our design. Were it not glory that we more affected than the performance of our heaving spleens, I would not wish a drop of Trojan blood spent more in her defense. But worthy Hector, she is a theme of honor and renown, a spur to valiant and magnanimous deeds, whose present courage may beat down our foes, and fame in time to come can knownize us. For I presume brave Hector would not lose so rich advantage of a promised glory as smiles upon the forehead of this action, for the wide world's revenue.
I am yours, you valiant offspring of great Priamus. I have a roisting challenge sent amongst the dull and factious nobles of the Greeks, will strike amazement to their drowsy spirits. I was advertised their great general slept, whilst emulation in the army crept. This, I presume, will wake him.
How now, Thersites?
What?
Lost in the labyrinth of thy fury? Shall the elephant Ajax carry it thus? He beats me, and I rail at him. Oh, worthy satisfaction would it were otherwise, that I could beat him whilst he railed at me. Soot, I'll learn to conjure and raise devils, but I'll see some issue of my spiteful execrations. Then there's Achilles. A rare engine. If Troy be not taken till these two undermine it, the walls will stand till they fall of themselves. Oh, thou great thunder darter of Olympus, forget that thou art Jove, the king of gods, and Mercury. Lose all the serpentine craft of thy Caduceus. If ye take not that little less than little wit from them that they have, which short-armed ignorance itself knows is so abundant scarce, it will not in circumvention deliver a fly from a spider without drawing their massy irons and cutting the web. After this, the vengeance on the whole camp, or rather the Neapolitan bonehead, for that, methinks, is a curse dependent on those that war for a placket. I have said my prayers, and devil envy say amen.
What ho, my lord Achilles!
Who's there? Thersites?
Good Thersites, come in and rest.
If I could have remembered a gilt counterfeit, thou wouldst not have slipped out of my contemplation. But 'tis no matter, thyself upon thyself. The common curse of mankind, folly and ignorance, be thine in great revenge. Heaven bless thee from a tutor, and discipline come not near thee. Let thy blood be thy direction to thy death. Then, if she that lays thee out says thou art a fair course, I'll be sworn and sworn upon it. She never shrouded any but Lazarus. Amen. Where's Achilles?
What? Art thou devout? Wast thou in prayer?
Aye, the heavens hear me.
Amen.
Who's there?
Thersites, my lord.
Where, oh, where? Art thou come? Why, my cheese, my digestion? Why hast thou not served thyself into my table so many meals? Come, what's Agamemnon?
Thy commander, Achilles. Then tell me, Patroclus, what's Achilles?
Thy lord, Thersites. Then tell me, I pray thee, what's thyself?
Thy knower, Patroclus. Then tell me, Patroclus, what art thou?
Thou mayst tell that knowest.
Oh, tell.
I'll decline the whole question. Agamemnon commands Achilles. Achilles is my lord. I am Patroclus's knower. And Patroclus is a fool.
You rascal!
This fool I have not done.
He is a privileged man. Proceed, Thersites.
Agamemnon is a fool. Achilles is a fool. Thersites is a fool. And as aforesaid, Patroclus is a fool.
Derive this. Come.
Agamemnon is a fool to offer to command Achilles. Achilles is a fool to be commanded of Agamemnon. Thersites is a fool to serve such a fool. And Patroclus is a fool positive.
Hmm? Well, why am I a fool?
Make that demand of the Creator. It suffices me that thou art. Look you, who comes here?
Patroclus, I'll speak with nobody. Come in with me, Thersites.
Here is such patchery, such juggling, and such knavery. All the argument is a whore and a cuckold. A good quarrel to draw emulous factions and bleed to death upon. Now the dry serpigo on the subject. And war and lechery confound all.
Where is Achilles?
Within his tent, but ill-disposed, my lord.
Let it be known to him that we are here. We sent our messengers, and we lay by our appertainments visiting of him. Let him be told so, lest perchance he think we dare not move the question of our place, or know not what we are.
I shall say so to him.
We saw him at the opening of his tent. He is not sick.
Yes, lying sick. Sick of proud heart. You may call it melancholy if you will favor the man, but by my head, 'tis pride. But why? Why? Let him show us the cause. A word, my lord.
What moves Ajax thus to bear him?
Achilles hath inveigled his fool from him.
Who, Thersites?
He.
Then will Ajax lack matter if he have lost his argument?
No, you see, he is his argument that has his argument, Achilles.
All the better. Their fraction is more our wish than their faction. But it was a strong composure a fool could disunite.
The amity that wisdom knits not, folly may easily untie. Here comes Patroclus.
No Achilles with him.
The elephant hath joints, but none for courtesy. His legs are legs for necessity, not for flexure.
Achilles bids me say he is much sorry if anything more than your sport and pleasure did move your greatness in this noble state to call upon him. He hopes it is no other but for your health and your digestion's sake, an after-dinner's breath.
Hear you, Patroclus. We are too well acquainted with these answers, but his evasion, winged thus swift with scorn, cannot outfly our apprehensions. Much attribute he hath, and much the reason why we ascribe it to him. Yet all his virtues, not virtuously on his own part beheld, do in our eyes begin to lose their gloss, yea, like fair fruit in an unwholesome dish are like to rot untasted. Go and tell him, we come to speak with him. And you shall not sin if you do say we think him over-proud and under-honest, in self-assumption greater than in the note of judgment, and worthier than himself. Here, tend the savage strangeness he puts on. disguise the holy strength of their command, and underwrite, in an observing kind, his humorous predominance. Yea, watch his pettish looms, his ebbs and flows, as if the passage and whole carriage of this action rode on his tide. Go tell him this, and add that if he overhold his price so much, will none of him, but let him, like an engine not portable, lie under this report. Bring action hither. This cannot go to war. A stirring dwarf we do allowance give before a sleeping giant. Tell him so.
I shall, and bring his answer presently.
In second voice we'll not be satisfied. We come to speak with him. Ulysses, enter you.
What is he more than another?
No more than what he thinks he is.
Is he so much? Do you not think he thinks himself a better man than I am?
No question.
Well, will you subscribe his thought and say he is?
No, noble Ajax. You are as strong, as valiant, as wise, no less noble, much more gentle, and altogether more tractable.
Why should a man be proud? How doth pride grow? I know not what pride is.
Your mind is the clearer, Ajax, and your virtues the fairer. He that is proud eats up himself. Pride is his own glass, his own trumpet, his own chronicle. And whatever praises itself, but in the deed, devours the deed in the praise.
I do hate a proud man as I do hate the engendering of toads.
Yet he loves himself. Is not strange?
Achilles will not to the field tomorrow.
What's his excuse?
He doth rely on none, but carries on the stream of his dispose without observance or respect of any, in will peculiar and in self-admission.
Why will he not, upon our fair request, untent his person and share the air with us?
Things small as nothing for request's sake only he makes important. Possessed he is with greatness, and speaks not to himself, but with a pride that quarrels at self-breath. Imagined worth holds in his blood such swollen and hot discourse that twixt his mental and his active parts, kingdomed Achilles in commotion rages and batters down himself. What should I say? He is so plaguy proud that the death tokens of it cry no recovery.
Let Ajax go to him. Dear Lord, go you and greet him in his tent. Said he holds you well and will be led, at your request, a little from himself.
Oh, Agamemnon, let it not be so. We'll consecrate the steps that Ajax makes when they go from Achilles. Shall the proud lord that bastes his arrogance with his own seam, and never suffers matter of the world enter his thoughts, save such as doth revolve and ruminate himself? Shall he be worshipped, of that we hold an idol more than he? No, this thrice worthy and right valiant lord must not so stale his palm, nobly acquired, nor by my will as subjugate his merit, as amply titled as Achilles is, by going to Achilles. That were to enlarge his fat already pride, and add more coals to Cancer when he burns, with entertaining great Hyperion. This lord go to him, Jupiter forbid, and say in thunder, Achilles, go to him.
Oh, this is well. He rubs the vein of him.
And how his silence drinks up this applause.
If I go to him, with my armed fist, I'll pash him o'er the face.
Oh, no, you shall not go.
And I'll be proud with me. I'll feize his pride. Let me go to him.
Not for the worth that hangs upon our quarrel.
A paltry, insolent fellow.
How he describes himself.
Can he not be sociable?
The raven chides blackness.
I'll let his humour's blood.
He will be the physician that should be the patient.
And all men were of my mind.
Wit would be out of fashion.
I should not bear it so. I should eat swords first. Shall pride carry it?
And twould you'd carry half.
I would have 10 shares.
I'll need him. I'll make him supple.
He's not yet through warm. Force him with praises. Pour in, pour in. His ambition is dry.
My lord, you feed too much on this dislike.
Our noble general, do not do so.
You must prepare to fight without Achilles. Why it is this naming of him does him harm? Here is a man, but 'tis before his face. I will be silent.
Wherefore should you so? He is not emulous as Achilles is.
No, the whole world, he is as valiant.
horse and dog that shall palter thus with us? Would he were a Trojan?
What a vice were it in Ajax now.
If he were proud.
Or covetous of praise.
Aye, or surly born.
Or strange or self-affected.
Thank the heavens, Lord, thou art of sweet composure. Praise him that got thee, she that gave thee suck. Famed be thy tutor, and thy parts of nature thrice famed beyond all erudition. But he that disciplined thine arms to fight, let Mars divide eternity in twain and give him half. And for thy vigor, bull-bearing Milo his addition yield to sinewy Ajax. I will not praise thy wisdom, which, like a bourne, a pale, a show, confines thy spacious and dilated parts. Here's Nestor, instructed by the antiquary times. He cannot but be wise. But pardon, Father Nestor, were your days as green as Ajax, and your brain so tempered, you should not have the eminence of him, but be as Ajax.
Shall I call you father?
Aye, my good son.
Be ruled by him, Lord Ajax. There is no tarrying here. The heart Achilles keeps thicket. Please it our great general to call together all his state of war. Fresh kings are come to Troy. Tomorrow we must with all our main of power stand fast. And here's a lord. Come knights from east to west and cull their flower, Ajax shall cope the best.
Go we to council. Let Achilles sleep. Light boats sail swift, though greater hulks draw deep.